Thank you, thank you. I'd like to thank the Museum of Natural History for having me tonight, and thank you all for coming out in the rain to hear a little bit about love. Hopefully, you'll find it interesting. I know it's around Valentine's Day, so you're interested in talking about love with your partner, but I'm gonna talk about babies. And so my research aims to bridge the gap between nature and nurture. Things that are innate, things that we are born with, versus things that were learned, and what biology gives us versus the way we can adapt to biology and how we can learn and adapt in an environment. And why is this essential? It's essential for our survival. And not just our survival as individuals, but the survival of our lineage, of our genetics, usually through our offspring. And I study how mothers interact with their offspring for their offspring's survival. And babies have a limited ability to interact with their caregivers. They can do one of a few things to let them know, let you know, us as caregivers, know how they're feeling. One example is here. So we know that baby's enjoying her time. And another way babies communicate is through this. And I hope you're asking yourself, who would record this poor baby crying instead of going to pick them up? That's my daughter. So in the same manner that offspring make cues that we as caregivers take care of them, mice do the same thing. And mice are my model organism that I use to study how brains change. These are the mice babies that I use. They're called mouse pups. Yeah, they're super cute. And when they get cold, they emit something called an ultrasonic vocalization. And that's shown here. It's plotted frequency over time. Are there any musicians in the room? Musicians? Would you like to sing this? You can't, it's ultrasonic. Which means it's above our hearing range, so you can't really hear it. But it's plotted frequency over time. So if I was to sing it downgraded, it would be like, woo, 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 woo. And those sounds alert the mom. So when she's in the nest and a pup gets out of the nest, she'll orient towards a pup, she'll pick it up, and she'll bring it back to the nest. And I'll show you an example of that here. Virgin females, however, animals that have never given birth to a pup, won't perform this task. They'll ignore the pup, and sometimes they'll cannibalize the pup. I'm not going to show you that, though. And herein lies the question. How does an existing social cue, the sound of a baby crying that is consistent between both groups, gain relevance after an experience? And this experience is the experience of motherhood. And we had a candidate neuromodulator, a candidate chemical that we wanted to check out, and that was the love drug oxytocin. Oxytocin is released from a part of the brain called the paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus. So if everyone can take their left hand and put it on their nose, and their right hand and put it right on top of their ear, well, this is a great picture. And and where the two fingers meet, that's where your paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus that projects to the pituitary gland is. That's where your oxytocin is released. That's where the magic happens. In mice, who also have a paraventricular nucleus of their hypothalamus, oxytocin is released and can get through the body. It's released during, through a myriad ways. During sex, it's released during orgasms. It's shown to increase trust and generosity. It's also important for pair bonding. So here's an example of a vole. And the way oxytocin operates in the brain of a vole is very intriguing. Here's an example of a prairie vole. They're monogamous. So after they find a mate, the male decides to stay with the female and they raise children together. The montane voles, however, they're polygamous. So they go from female to female and they don't stay with their litter. And what's interesting here is their brains respond to oxytocin differently, which makes it such a candidate molecule for us to study. Oxytocin is also essential for the birthing process. If anyone's ever been induced, They give the correlate, which is Pitocin, in the hospital to induce birth. It causes uterine contractions, and it causes milk letdown. So it's essential for breastfeeding and continually released during breastfeeding for pair bonding. It's also released during touch and eye contact and prolonged hugs. Given such a beautiful molecule, I found it really interesting when I was looking up information when I first started this project that showed that the hype about oxytocin is dumb and dangerous. Ed Young, who is a very prominent neuroscientist writer, called it oxytocin schmoxytocin and said it was overrated. I also found you can find it on Amazon. Don't find it on Amazon. It's not really oxytocin. But I was a little bit perturbed going into this question, wanting to use oxytocin as a target molecule, but realizing that there's not much work done on how oxytocin really works. So I decided to address the hard science of oxytocin. And so today I'm going to talk to you about where it works in the brain, on what time scale in mice, and how it actually changes the brain to make subpar caregivers better caregivers. So first, let's check out where. I hypothesized that it would be in the hearing centers of the brain, given that when a baby pup cries, the mother's first reaction is to orient towards the pup. So maybe the hearing centers of the brain, called the primary auditory cortex, were really important in this discovery. Here's an example of the auditory cortex here, circled in the hearing area of the schematic of the brain. And in the brain, we have neurons, and these neurons respond to different molecules. Oxytocin, for example, caffeine, THC. Oxytocin is also not Oxycontin. It's different. I'm going to point that out. And so these neurons in the brain respond and fire when certain drugs hit them. How does that happen? It happens because each neuron has a specific receptor on it. The receptors take the molecule, attach it to the neuron, and that allows the neuron to fire, to propagate, and to have a conversation with the other neurons in their milieu. Because we were able to dabble with the oxytocin receptor, what we did is we made all the cells red. Before we were able to make the cells red, we couldn't find an oxytocin receptor antibody, which means I can use a drug to add it to the oxytocin receptor and it'll turn the cell red. So we didn't know where oxytocin was. So we created a novel antibody. Each one of the dots here are cells, neurons. These are real neurons in the brain. Out of the brain, because I took a picture of them. And they're stained with red, which means they're oxytocin receptor. What we saw, which was really surprising, was that there are more oxytocin receptors in the left side of the brain than the right side of the brain when it came to the auditory cortex. And why we were so excited about this is because it was the first opportunity to show lateralization to auditory cortex. And why is this exciting? Because in humans, we have lateralization. The Broca-Wernicke area is usually found on the left side of right-handed people, and that's an area for communication. So we may have found a locus for communication, given that oxytocin is on the left auditory cortex more than the right. We also looked at different types of cells in the auditory cortex. So there are excitatory cells and inhibitory cells. And I would think of it like this. Excitatory cells are like the kids in the front of the bus that are like making a whole lot of noise and they're really excited. And then like, oh, I guess in the back of the bus, they make noise. I haven't taken the bus in a long time. The kids in the back of the bus make a lot of noise. And like the nuns in the front of the bus, I also went to Catholic school, the nuns in the front of the bus are telling everyone to quiet down. And those are the inhibitory cells. So you have the people that are making the noise and the people that are telling other people to quiet down, and that's how balancing happens in the brain. And we showed that there are oxytocin receptors on both the loud cells and also the quieting cells. So the loud cells are in green and the quiet cells are in red. So oxytocin can both make things spike more or spike less, which means it has a lot of control in the brain. When does it work? I did an experiment where I have a pup in a chamber. The pup is shown here as a little green pup. I put a virgin animal that's not cannibalizing but will ignore the pup. And I want to... A lot of screening went through that experiment. And I wanted to see how the virgin would interact with the pup. When she didn't pick it up, which she normally didn't, I then treated her with oxytocin. I did it through something called an intraperitoneal injection, which means I'm injecting it into her body. I also use something called optogenetics. Opto meaning light, genetics meaning changing the genetics. And so what optogenetics does is we have an animal that allows neurons to fire when we shine light in the brain. We genetically modified it so that every time we shine light, the neurons fire. So I'm releasing endogenous oxytocin, oxytocin from the animal's own body, and using that to see the behavior. I then put her in the chamber with the mom. So after she has the flood of oxytocin, she can see how a real caregiver does it, and she can sit back and learn. And so here's an example of a video in which we have the blue light shining in the brain. You'll see a fiber and a blue light shining in the brain. And this animal that originally was not retrieving at all is all of a sudden retrieving very well based on the release of oxytocin. She learned. And when we illuminated the left auditory cortex, we were able to get this behavior. Just shining light in the left auditory cortex, the left hearing centers, allowed for an animal to become a better caregiver. We then wanted to know, how does this work? What's changing in the brain to allow for a behavioral change? In order to check that out, I did something called whole cell in vivo physiology. It's a whole mouthful, and it's actually a really hard technique, but I'm going to walk you guys through it, so by the end you'll be whole cell in vivo physiologists. What I do is I have an animal who's anesthetized. So she's usually on a ketamine trip, to be in all truth. We give him ketamine, so she's not feeling any pain, but she can also still hear. We play the pup call, and I record from a neuron in the brain to look at spiking activity, to see how the neuron's talking to its immediate neighbors. How do you record from a very small, like 10 to 20 microns, very small neuron in the brain? I take a glass pipette, pretty much like a glass straw, I heat it over fire, and I pull it. And so the opening is about less than 10 microns, maybe on the order of 5 microns. And then I do something really, really sophisticated. I take a tube, I stick it on the other end of that pulled straw, and I take that part, and I put it to my mouth. And then what I do is I kiss it while it's in the brain until I find a cell and kind of suck the cell onto the tip. And that's whole cell in vivo physiology. And once I'm able to kiss onto the cell so I can record from a single cell in the brain, I can see spiking activity because neurons are electrical and that's how they communicate with their neighbors. And so I'm going to show you a few traces that I actually recorded from single neurons in awake animals, in alive animals. And as you can see here, there are three spikes. So every time I play the pup call in a mother, this is an anesthetized mother, we see a spike that happens at the same time. That means that neuron is encoding a message. Every one of these lines is a different time I play that call, and every time the neuron's firing at the same exact time. It's trying to tell their other neighbors something. However, in a virgin animal, this is a different call because I use a call that makes the best response. In a naive animal, we see spiking, but there's nothing that's time-locked. There's nothing that's actually encoding a message. It's kind of like just making noise. However, after a virgin learns to retrieve, just in the auditory neurons in the brain, you start to see that time-locked response, that neuron's firing and encoding a message. And so I wanted to ask, how am I making a virgin's brain into a mother's brain by adding oxytocin? And because of whole cell physiology, we were able to answer that question. So I patched onto a cell in a virgin mouse. I played the pup call, and I looked at the spikes that her neurons told me. I then illuminated the area that I was recording from to release oxytocin endogenously. So I'm using its own oxytocin from its own body in that area I'm recording from while playing the pup call. What we start to see is that the neuron starts to fire a lot more. There's an increase in its excitability. And after about 3 hours of recording from the cell, we start to see this time-locked response. We saw in real time how the brain changed from an inexperienced caregiver to an experienced caregiver just in the hearing parts of the brain. And so I answered, where is this happening? In the auditory areas. When is it happening? Very quickly. And how? By changing the way the neurons fire in the brain, to change the response to the pup call. And finally, now if you search oxytocin on Google, you will get a lot less of its trash and its oxytocin, schmoxytocin, because this study actually picked up a lot of good press, which is really exciting for us as scientists to be able to illuminate some area that's unknown prior and give some information to the bigger scientific community. And so it was covered in National Geographic and Science Magazine. And also, it got to the top 100 stories of 2015. Thanks, guys. Thank you. And so we looked at the natural oxytocin in the brain, but how the experience of hanging out with a good mom actually makes it better. We looked at how something that's innate, like giving birth, having a flood of oxytocin, and then being able to take care of your child works, but also it can be learned when given oxytocin. So there's a component that's innate and also a component that can be learned. It's something that biology gave us, but also something you can adapt to. It's further building that bridge. And that bridge is for the survival of their offspring. But when we take a step back and look at how oxytocin and mice can play a role in humanity, I think it's really important to understand that mice have a certain level in which they want to propagate their offspring. But we saw that virgins took care of pups that weren't their own. I think that's really important because it's not necessarily the propagation of your offspring, but it's the propagation of their species. I think that really applies to us as humans as well. Some of the work that motivates the science that I do come from these statistics. So 4 out of 7 children die a day from child neglect and abuse. The average life expectancy is 20 years shorter. Brains of neglected children have less white and gray matter. When I read this number, I just cringe because it's the financial impact of is enough to send one child to college, and we all know how much college costs. And so these studies, I think, are really important. But moreover, the reason why I think I'm so motivated to study how parental experiences and how supporting parents and supporting offspring better supports humanity is because of these two people and this precious child. All told me pop. So these are my parents, and that's me. My parents have taught me a lot in life, but one of the most important things that motivates my science is that they are my biological parents, but they were foster parents. So I grew up with foster brothers and sisters who came from other homes in which they weren't honored, in which they were not treated well, and whose parents had a hard time taking care of them. And so to grow up in an environment where my parents were able to take care of children that weren't their own, children came from different environments, and still seeing people live and thrive and learn really motivates the studies I do. And thank you for listening. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.